So
I'm just gonna tuck it back a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, now that movie would be really relevant.
You mean like Super Drones?
Super Drone. If it's called Super Drone.
That's right. It became.
And yeah but
it's like a thinking airplane that like comes alive like Herbie and but wants to kill everybody.
Right. Right. It's like a Herbie the Love Bug remake. Did the Herbie screenwriters get credit on Stealth?
I don't.
They must have. They must have. Just
special
story
thanks,
by.
Mostly special thanks.
Thanks.
For a great start of the interview.
Just show that part. Are we done?
There you go. That pretty much does it. Well, that that may be worth money. You could probably sell that pitch.
I just made $1 million.
You could sell
awesome
that pitch for
Hollywood pitch.
$7 million.
All I need are the rights to Stealth, Herbie the Love Bug, and Lindsay Lohan.
But some studio would probably go for it at this point. Are you having a hard time pitching these days? Is it people going, oh, no, I don't think so.
We have a hard time pitching because we fall asleep in the middle of our pitches because we're very tired.
We're not doing a lot of pitching right now.
No.
The only thing I want to pitch is tent so I can sleep in it.
Oh, nice. Wow.
See, exactly. This
you're
is why.
The really
we got to burn out. We're out of ideas.
This is the end. Goodbye, Hollywood.
So is your thing now to make 5 million movies every year? Is that your goal?
We do have a third secret movie that we're going to drop like Beyonce later this year.
It's volume. That's how a film career is measured.
Yeah.
That's why, like, Roger Corman is the best filmmaker.
Quantity,
of all time.
Quantity is very close to the word quality.
Yeah.
Have you guys hung out with Roger Corman?
No.
I would
so
love
would
to.
Probably enjoy
what's
it.
His deal?
He's like he's still in the same office he's been in for the last 40 years over in Brentwood.
And he's still doing stuff.
Still got Sharknado on his you know,
right.
desktop.
Oh, that's right.
Or whatever.
That's him.
And he's like, but there are a bunch of those. Like you see the scripts on his desk, and it's all like.
Now it's all like.
Deathnado, Dognado,
right, yeah. All tornado-based film. Yes. That's amazing.
That's his riff.
That's really.
But you guys good. Would actually find some sort of way to probably meld him into something him.
We should make a Roger Corman movie.
Bear,
I'm putting it out there.
Yeah. Bear
Roger
quake.
Corman, call me. Second
bit.
Something. What do those movies take?
Like
a few weeks?
Like 6 days to shoot.
That
yeah.
That's so fun.
Well, that's probably the fun of it is that I actually
limited.
Let's just
make one really fast.
Yeah. Would you guys would probably enjoy doing that.
Yeah. Totally. I think so.
Bearquake is an
cut
earthquake
to
of bears.
Yeah, Bearquake. Cut to the middle of the Bearquake shoot. And me
why did we agree to do this?
Each other.
Why did we agree to do this? It doesn't make sense.
Up.
Bears can't beat
can't
an earthquake.
I can't do this anymore. Yeah, Lord & Miller walk-off set of Bearquake. That's
so,
a scoop I'm giving you
there
from
you
the future.
Go before.
Yeah.
So are you guys sick of each other yet? Is that what we're heading towards?
So sick. So sick that we're going on vacation right next door to each other by accident.
Really?
I was trying to nod while you said no.
Oh, sorry. No, not at all. Absolutely. We are not sick of you. What?
Mean...
No, we're we are just really, you can tell by this interview how tired we are.
Has it been, what has it been, 13, 14?
Let's do the whole interview like this.
13, 14 years?
This is the most I've touched Chris in 1 year.
Has it been, like, 13, 14, 15 years? Something like that? You guys
more? Even more.
Like 20, really.
We met in 1993 in college, and then we started helping each other out. But we moved out here in 97 and started working together, so.
And have
math.
You ever cheated on each other? Is that over?
Well,
as partners. As
I'm married,
so,
so
that's cheating.
In a sense,
he's been cheating
I've been
on me with his
sleeping
wife.
With someone else
with his female
for,
wife. But
for
have
a
you
while,
with her,
I've not been riding with her at all. No, no, she's less into that.
Yeah. She's less into that.
Less into the like,
were you, like
writing
you got,
screenplays.
Like, your anniversary was last night.
It was.
Did you get home from the restaurant and take each other's clothes off and then pitch ideas
yeah, we
for
were pitching
Lego 2?
Exactly.
Well, they were on mushrooms, apparently.
Yeah, it was delicious. We did go to this place, Maud. I highly recommend
it. Oh, it worked out.
It was awesome. It all worked
what
out.
What happened? There was a whole
it was a whole thing.
Controversy,
thing.
But it worked out.
It all worked out great.
All right.
Guys.
They found out who it was.
Yeah. They found out it was based on the show starring Bea Arthur. Mod.
The food program.
Yeah.
Do you guys have food clout now? Do you call up and say,
I wish, but this was very difficult for me to get this reservation, but it all
you
worked
would
out.
Think.
No, we don't have clout of any kind. It's crazy.
This is it.
Here we are.
Do you wish to have, I mean, seriously though, do you guys?
It's not our thing.
I honestly think restaurant reservations are the one benefit that I would be looking for. Everything else is just a complication, right?
I agree.
So you have so much going on now that you can't even.
We don't even have time to go to restaurants. That's the thing. We're making two movies a year.
Intravenously put into our bodies.
I just want to eat some sort of energy paste and then just keep moving.
There's that guy. Did you?
Yeah, exactly.
There's a guy who does that. Yeah.
Some guy in Northern California invented some weird energy paste where there's no waste and you don't poop.
Wow.
Anyway, it's going to be great. If you don't like eating food and having
so
pleasurable experiences with your friends,
well, you know, actually, it's the best thing to do. Snowpiercer in the Bong Joon-ho movie.
Yeah.
They're eating protein bars,
right.
Like Jell-O.
Yes.
And that's how they survive.
I heard that was a good movie.
It's
good?
It's a really good movie, actually.
I'm excited to see it.
I'm looking forward to you guys remaking it in English.
The Jell-O movie? Yeah.
The Snowpiercer.
The Jell-O movie.
Is that it? Everything with an O now?
Yes.
All your movies end with an O?
Indeed.
That's true.
So, this movie... Which movie are we on?
22 Jump Street?
22 Jump Street.
Okay.
Yes.
Does this feel like a lifetime ago already? It's opening today, but...
We're in the offices. There's nothing left here.
It's the 22 Jump Street.
This is the
offices.
Avid that we thought we were going to use all the time. Yeah, and we only use this. Like four times.
But does it feel like you did this a year ago and now you're on to other things and released?
No, we finished this movie two weeks ago.
Yeah, a few weeks ago. It's crazy. We turned it over the very latest ever possible. And the people at Deluxe who were doing, you know, the prints were like, we've never gotten a film this close to how when we had to, like, turn it over.
They were mad.
They were very upset. So because we were so compressed in our time schedule, we also like to keep working with things until they pull it out of our hands and force us to stop. So it was crazy. This movie, we made those end credits, like, 6 weeks ago.
Last Thursday we finished
them. And did you have to shoot them or did you?
Yeah, we shot them here on the lot. We were like, we have this crazy idea for end credits. Jonah and Chan come
here.
That's
where all the ideas were.
Yeah, there was a whiteboard right here where we had like listed a bunch and tried to figure out how many we could get done in a day. And we were like, okay, we're going to just put you in a bunch of different costumes. It's going to be crazy. And so we shot it here on the Sony lot in one day. We had the help of Alma Mater, who was making all the other, like the animated and the video game and other stuff.
The animated and the...
I don't want to give it all away in case people haven't seen the movie.
This is airing live, right?
Right.
The police are coming in.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you've talked about this before, but the idea of doing a sequel, which you guys haven't actually directed any of your own sequels until now. So was it intimidating? Was it obvious? Was it just going to be fun?
We said no at first. We said no, thank you. And they said, just think about it. And we said, and they said, come on. and then we started to think about it. And then once we thought of something that we kind of liked, we're like, okay, we'll give it a try. And then,
come on is a really good argument to make if you want to convince us to do something.
Come on, don't
come on.
Don't wuss out on this.
The first Jump Street we did because Neil Moritz called us pussies if we didn't do it.
Really?
It's true.
True story. And then this one is because Neil Moritz is like, come on.
It's not easy.
Yeah, we're real pushovers.
So was it like an impossible fit into your schedule at that point? And just like,
yeah, it was a terrible idea. We were still making the Lego movie, and it was like, it was going to be crazy idea to do two movies at once.
The thing that happens in this town is that the filmmakers will be like, this makes no sense. Like, this, it's impossible. And the studio people will be like,
it's going to work.
It'll be fine.
Don't worry about
it. You'll figure it out.
It's going to be great.
And then you kind of do.
Yeah, and then we're like...
You don't see your family for a long time.
It's fine. Whatever.
So how much of this was...
It's like...
not how much of it was written.
Cats in the Cradle. It's going to be great.
Yeah.
How much it was like getting it... How settled was it when you finally started shooting? Or was there a lot that was still...
There was still a lot in the air. I mean, you know, we're working with great people. You know, Michael Bacall and Oren Uziel and then Rodney Rothman. And we were just kept working on it. And, you know, every day we would work on the next day's pages, and then even that day we'd be like, let's do this to the scene, and then we would print out new pages for those guys at the last second, like right before they were coming on set. They're like, thanks, guys, this is great. And then they're really good improvisers, too, so they were adding a bunch of stuff themselves, and they're really smart about story and character. And so it was, you know, a real rush, but a great team effort.
And were they, was it different this time? Was it easier with the guys this time? Were they adding more because they'd been done it before with you?
It was a little easier. I thought that they both got better just as actors, and they were already good. So that was a great boon for us. And then they were more comfortable. Certainly Channing was more comfortable with the process and was excited to improvise instead of being miserable.
Or terrified. Like the first time, you know, he didn't realize how great and funny he was. That was part of what's wonderful about him, is that you'd think that he'd be super egotistical for being handsome and talented and great at everything he does.
He's like the only super handsome, incredibly talented person who's like modest and insecure.
Right.
And it makes him super lovable.
And he was like very concerned that he was going to fall on his face in a not funny pratfall way on the first one and be like embarrassed if he was like trying to improvise with Jonah and people who are like famous as the world's best improvisers. Mm-hmm. And after the first one came out and he saw that he actually is good and people liked him, then this time it was a lot easier that he was much, much more comfortable and just allowed himself to be himself, and which is charming and delightful.
And not only was it for you guys, the tight schedule and last minute and everything else, but one of the big gags of the film is everything bigger.
Yes.
Yeah, more visual and everything.
Bigger is always better.
It's a gag. Super fun gag to shoot.
Yes.
We added like 10 days to the first unit schedule, I think 2 weeks to the, or maybe three, to the second unit schedule. We had to shut down the port of New Orleans to go shoot there.
It was crazy. I mean, the funnier conversations with the studio going, no, the joke is that it's more expensive, you see.
Right.
So we need more money. And they're like, I don't know about that joke.
That joke's not. That joke's not making us laugh a lot over here in the budget department.
So Moritz didn't actually say, here's double the money to go do the movie?
No. We certainly did not get double the budget on this, but we stretched it as far as we could.
Yes.
But do you guys feel like you were doing more? I mean, it is visually more.
We did more.
Oh, yes. We definitely did more.
No, it was definitely a heavier shoot. There's like helicopters flying around.
Yeah, we had more explosions, more car chases, more everything.
And every day there was like a crazy thing happening.
Yeah.
That on the first movie would have been like the most difficult day. And that was just like, oh, wait, all right, this afternoon, what? We're doing a stunt where Channing like jumps down four stories, like Spider-Man.
Yeah, that was just.
I guess okay, cool. Let's fire it up.
Yeah, so it definitely was big. We had much more stunt work and green screen shenanigans, but it was bigger is better. Sometimes
is better. It was also because we were going so quickly that we almost were naive to like how big it was while we were doing it. So you were only like half a day ahead of the crew, and we would show up. You know, we typically show up an hour before call and just kind of sit on the set and go, "All right, let me get this day. Let me get my head around this day and see if we can make sense of it." And we kind of made the whole movie that way because we were so fast.
Yeah. And because during prep, we were still changing the script a lot, and we were working on Lego, so, you know, it's not like we were like, okay, we've got the whole movie storyboarded, and now we just have to sit back and execute. It was a lot of...
Our DP is working on another movie right now, and he's like, I'm like, how's it going? He's like, it's crazy. We've been, like, shot listing. We storyboard the sequences before we shoot them. It's... Guys, we got to try this next time. It's really fun.
So this was not about expanding your visual palette. It's not like, okay, well, we're going to do something more. It sounds like
we were trying to do something. I mean, we were. That's the problem, is that we would get on set and be like, oh, you know, it'd be really cool to do this crazy split screen effect. And they'd be like, all right, that's going to be very difficult. and so that was sort of, that's the problem with us.
Yes.
Because we have
a big appetite. Yeah. We always want to do more than what the budget allows. But we tried to tell ourselves that it was spontaneous.
Right.
Like, it was fun to make a movie in a way that felt like you were coming up with new things all the time.
Well, it feels like scene by scene or sequence by sequence that, you know, whatever the core idea was kind of there, and then it's like you could almost feel that everybody was adding another layer and another layer and another layer.
Yeah, and it's the actors are improvising, and then we're like behind the scenes going like, oh, you know what would be cool? Like, should we, let's see if we can get a Lamborghini, a little mini Lamborghini, and have Channing like ride around on it. And that's like at lunch. And then somebody's running like crazy to go get one of those things. And that's part of the fun. That's part of the fun for us. It definitely felt sometimes kind of like a tiny independent movie crew, because you would sit there going like, oh, you know what would be funny? And then everybody was in on the creativity, and you know, even though it was taxing on the crew, they enjoyed it because they were able to get ideas into the movie all the time.
So has that always been your guys' nature? And you now just have more budget and more people?
No.
I mean, in animation, everything is so much more planned out, and there's not like you show up on set and there's the day. You're like, we do keep adding stuff all the time, and we never stop trying to like add extra ideas even when it's too late, but which can be frustrating to others. But so that is kind of our MO. But this one was definitely the loosest we've ever worked, and we had to find a movie in the editing room because the first assembly of the movie was 4 hours long, and we were like, oh God. How are we going to get a movie out of this? The fact that we got under 2 hours is kind of a miracle. But there's
so
a lot
is there a fun 2.5 hour cut?
No. There's a really bad two and a half hour
cut that has a lot of funny things, but you get really tired.
The best way to experience it is the way you'll see it on the DVD, which are individual scenes. You know, this is a great scene by itself. Mm-hmm. And when you see it in sequence, you kind of fall asleep because the story wants to go this way and the scene's going that way.
Yeah, especially
much like Apocalypse Now.
Much like Apocalypse Now, but but the opposite.
Yeah. So, is there anything you didn't get that you were desperate to get?
There were plenty of things that we thought we absolutely needed while we were shooting, and even afterwards. But at the end of the day, like, the movie tells you what it needs, and then you find it, and then you feel crazy for insisting on that thing that was just going to delay the movie for 5 minutes. Don't you think?
Yeah. We shot a lot of movies, so I don't think we were like, oh man, I wish.
Yeah, exactly.
We could have had a 5 hour cut. Then we would have had
that,
something.
That would have been great.
Then we would have had something.
So, besides restaurant reservations, are you guys feeling your oats these days? I mean, it is kind of a crazy.
Are you? You've moment. Gotten really cocky lately.
I'm super cocky. Look out, guys.
But seriously, I mean, you guys now have a lot of power. You probably could sell a pitch that you think is ridiculous for $3 million.
That'd be fun. Should we think of something and try to sell it as a
right
joke?
Right now, yeah. Worst idea ever.
And see if we can put that to the test, maybe.
So we can sell the worst idea ever?
I don't feel that way. I don't know how you feel. I just feel super nervous.
We're always
and insecure all the time. I can barely sit through a screening.
Yeah.
At the premiere, I left in the middle and got a chicken sandwich because I couldn't take it anymore. It's just not my temperament to feel cocky about stuff. It's my temperament and place in life to feel embarrassed about everything.
We have two emotions, which are anxiety and then relief.
And relief, yeah.
That's it.
And right now it's anxiety, and in
theory, hopefully this movie comes out and does well, and then we will feel relief for like a few days
but
or
then
hours.
We'll be worried about like
what's the
tomorrow
next
morning
one?
We'll be like, how's Sunday gonna play?
Yeah.
Oh no, is How to Train Your Dragon gonna, I mean, it doesn't matter.
So are you gonna read all the box office stories and to see who?
You're a troller.
No, I definitely troll the internet.
I'm more avoidant, and I like we'll call Chris and ask, how are we doing? I can't even look. How's that New York Times review? Can I look at it? Or will it put me in a tailspin?
And on Sunday, like the Lego movie, on Sunday, did you just have a happy conversation and eat barbecue? Or were you comfortable that day at least?
Yeah.
Well, we were, I can't remember where you were.
We were here.
We were here.
Yeah.
In this room?
I remember when we got the final week box office, I was actually watching The Wolf of Wall Street.
There it is.
At home.
Pratt and I and our significant others were in Ojai.
Yes, I think that's right.
at that point, just like checking obsessively, checking phones.
So you'll be checking your phone all weekend.
Oh yeah. Yes. Oh yeah.
And does Absolutely. It? Do you sense that it matters? I mean, do you feel
it doesn't
like,
really
like the
matter.
Box out, like the performance of the movie, but, I mean, doesn't matter.
Do you feel it from the outside, or are you just it's your own internal clock?
It's a crazy just, thing. Like yeah. for me, it's mm-hmm. like a social thing. It's like you just did like the most embarrassing thing you could do at like a high school assembly. And then you're just like, am I gonna ever be invited to anything ever again? Am I like everybody saw it. And
what do they think?
What do they think? And I know they're telling me that they like it, but that's probably bullshit. like you just, I can't get away from that feeling of like, you just, like when you put a movie out, you're like, ta-da! And you're so exposed.
So does it ever go
and it's
away?
Not something I would do in life. It's not like I would go on stage
what is
somewhere
your life?
And do something. Do you know what I mean?
But it's yeah. your life.
But our life, your like, chosen life. Our day-to-day, you know, like this once a year, do. This happens where, you know, we have to do something and we have to do interviews and it's all public and there's billboards and stuff. The rest of the year is us sitting in a room like this,
okay, what's...
being introverts, talking to other yeah. introverts about how to make this thing better. And that's where I'm comfortable.
So when it's funny, is that, are you just completely relying on your own internal clocks to know what's funny?
No, I mean, yeah. we definitely at the beginning feel what's funny, but then you're working on these things for so long, you're editing it over and over again, you watch it 400 times, you're like, it's no longer funny after the fourth time.
Yeah.
And so you can't tell anymore, and you have to tell yourself, this used to be funny, I think it's still funny, and then you bring in friends or you show it to other people because your internal gauge is gone.
But when you're on set, do you have, you know when you have it? I mean, obviously you're shooting multiple
takes. You know
what's
weird is that there's like, there's on-set funny, and then there's in-the-movie funny, and sometimes they're not the same thing. Sometimes they are. Sometimes something's just undeniably funny. And other times it's like, that was hilarious on the set, and then you see it on the screen, and you're like...
It's a different thing.
It's not quite the same. And then other times there's things that didn't seem like there were anything on set, but are hilarious on the screen. Sort of a weird magic.
You just never know.
Yeah.
That's really the truth. That's why you get a lot of options, and you do your best to feel like you've exhausted every possible avenue for what could be funny in the scene, and then pray that that was enough.
Like, but at some point, they take away the movie from you.
Then they take away the movie. Yeah.
Exactly.
But you find out in editing, like, you have a decent sense. And then you'll show a two-hour cut of the movie, and you're like, I have no idea why these 10 jokes didn't work. Like, there were scenes where we were like, this is the funniest thing. I'm so excited. And you put it in front of an audience, and they don't laugh at all. And then you do it again, and you change it, and they're never going to laugh at it, and I have no idea why. Mm. And then you just cut it as tightly as possible and get out.
So is there anything in 22 that you didn't think was that funny but gets a huge laugh?
Oh, that's a good question.
There's a shot that always gets a laugh, which is Channing Tatum having, like, a puka necklace around his thick, thick neck. And everyone always laughs at it. And
I'm laughing at it
yeah.
now.
Yeah, exactly.
That's weird, though. We saw the movie twice this week. Yeah. Did you notice them laughing Tuesday and Wednesday night? Because now I'm like expecting something.
Right.
And I worry that it like went away somehow.
Well, it was still there. Still
it
laughs.
Was still there.
There's still laughs there.
You have more acute hearing than I do.
And that's one that we were always like, we didn't expect that to be a laugh. We just sort of thought it was like a little interesting detail, but audiences were always laughing at it. Like, that's so strange.
I didn't understand it. Yeah.
But doesn't somebody say puka beads at that point also?
Yeah, it says loose.
Like a combo joke.
But it's crazy.
Sometimes you just don't know. You're just like, they're laughing here. I don't know what it is, but don't change it.
Well, I think like the hardest gag in the movie to shoot and to know it's going to work is when Channing is kind of running around making fun, laughing, making jokes.
Yes, he That's discovers great. Some surprising information.
Yes.
And he gets very excited.
This was, you know, it was written that he just gets excited sitting in his chair. We did the rehearsal, and he's like, I would get up and run all over the place. And we're like,
oh,
that's awesome, but, you know.
We just turned this into a 15-hour day.
Because now we have to put cameras everywhere and cover this crazy
but
action
it's
that
worth,
he does.
But that's worth it.
But you're like.
And that's like one of them. It might be the biggest laugh in the whole movie, and it's because that's authentic to that character and to Chan, and you owe it to the audience and to yourselves to capture that.
But it was his idea, and then we were like, that's hilarious. Oh, my gosh, this would be great. And then it was even funnier, I think, when it was in the cut, where it was in the cut, and when you kind of wanted to see that. It was even funnier than we expected. And that was when we thought it was going to be funny.
Well, so much of comedy, so much of laughter is from the surprise.
Yeah.
But you can be surprised by the same gag over and over, I guess. But,
yeah.
You know, that thing is like, you never see that. I mean, it's like, yeah. I think somebody compared you to Frank Tashlin this week.
Oh, nice. Some review, I'll take that.
And
I'll
it does, take that it feels comparison. Like an old Tashlin, you know, yeah. a termite terrorist gag.
Yeah. I'll take that comparison all day. He's great.
Yeah.
Yeah, he had a real cartoony sensibility, that guy.
That thing is just like you're so in Channing's head at that moment. And his performance is really broad, but it ought to be. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he's also like a kind of subdued, he has like a subdued voice all the time.
He's often like sort of
and
like
he's whispering, and a lot of his stuff is small, like, and then when he blows up, huge.
You're like, whoa!
But that gets a bigger laugh than the thing the reveal of the thing that he's reacting to.
Which
and that's an important lesson.
Yeah,
in comedies, like a lot of times, just like the guy reacting to the thing is better than the thing.
So you have multiple reactions.
Yes, exactly.
All of which get big laughs.
And that's what it's about. It's about like watching the person realize something is better than when you realize it yourself.
Yeah, the Channing's reactions to Jonah's slam poetry is
get huge laughs.
As big as the laughs of his actual poem itself.
Yeah,
it's just weird.
It occurred to me that if you do a 20, what number are we up to? 23 jump three.
Yeah.
That you need to get Viola Davis now to do the.
Oh, no.
So people will never see the comedy coming.
Yes. Yes.
But she can kick ass in that regard. She could be Ice's mother, I guess. Or
yeah. Yeah, his sister or something.
Something.
Yeah.
To get the biggest laugh. So when you got to the ending and you suddenly saw your movie and you said, we don't want to have boring credits? Was that the.
How did we never want to have boring credits. But in this case, we had an ending where Channing and Jonah get invited to do another mission, and they say, "Nah, we're never doing this shit again," which is probably how they felt at the time that we shot it. And the audience, it just bums everybody out because at that point they like those guys so much and they're so invested in their relationship that they want happily ever after.
They're like, we want to see that they're going to go to graduate school or something.
We want to know that they're going to do this forever. So,
and so we're like, all right, well, we can give you that.
We can do that.
And you know,
challenge accepted.
And we thought it would be a good opportunity to sort of tweak how franchised movies have become. And so we, in this very room, spent like a half day coming up with potential other Jump Street ideas and spin-offs and merchandising. And then worked with this company, Alma Mater, and got it all done at the very, very, very last second. It was crazy.
Like, you get the feeling Channing will do almost anything at some point, you know, kind of different ideas, different kinds of movies.
Yes.
But you also get the feeling Jonah maybe this, you know, we're getting to his last comedies. He maybe wants to do Shakespeare soon.
He's so funny. That's the problem.
Yeah.
That's the problem he's going to come up against, is he's so funny at some point.
It's like Michael Jordan going, you know, I want to play baseball.
Yeah.
But, he's,
okay,
but turns out he's really good at baseball also.
That's awesome. But every once in a while, I want to see him play basketball too.
In this universe, Michael Jordan was also really good at baseball. Yeah.
Yes. That is the main difference, is that, like, I think Jonah has so much upside as a dramatic actor. And the fact that he can do both, and that he can do both in the same movie, that's what's awesome about, like, Wolf. Yeah. Is he's like hilarious and heartbreaking and, you know, terrifying all in one movie. Like I love him as Cyrus because he's that.
Right. Now you're comparing yourself to Scorsese. Just
I did not do that.
No.
You guys are just like Marty.
Yeah, absolutely.
We are. No.
So is there a difference for you between something about 20, in this case 22, but I mean a live action movie?
You know
versus
I mean?
Something like Lego? Does it feel any different when you...
It's getting less and less different, you know? The animation, as I was saying, is really... You have to plan everything in advance. You have complete control over, like, how many beads of sweat the person has on their forehead, you know? I mean, everything is planned out. Everything's storyboarded, and you have lots of chances to go in there. But it's also very, like, tight. And in live action, there's a lot more spontaneity. And you know, with people improvising, there's like a freshness there, but it's also sort of you have to embrace the looseness of it because you can't control everything. You know, you can't control the weather and that sort of thing. You know, and uh, But we, on Lego, we tried to make it much looser and try and get the actors together so that they could improvise their scenes together.
And the board artists were able to iterate over and over and over and over and over again. So the boarding process was really loose, which made for a terrifying movie from the studio's point of view, because it was always up in the air on Lego. And because you can constantly revise stuff in animation, and because you're constantly blowing up the story, even though you're planning it ahead of time, you're always examining the story and going, you know what would be better if, like, the boy, that boy was actually a girl, and da-da-da-da, and suddenly, like, you have to re-storyboard the whole movie. That process infected Jump Street.
Right.
Because on Jump Street, we would be like, you know what would be better for this scene is if it was, like, taking place over there, and what if we, and then suddenly, like, you're running around again.
But then we were also trying to storyboard things and control things that you can't actually control in live action. On the live action side, it was what we were taking from animation, like trying to do like visual, like Benny Hill gags and that sort of thing along the way.
So you guys are like,
they're colliding.
Book, like
we're trying to have them meet in the middle somewhere, so that everything is sort of halfway between live action and animation.
So does it change where you go from here? Or are you even able to think at this point with all of this going on?
It's helpful to not think too much about like shaping the catalog or the oeuvre, you know what I mean? Like, I feel like you lose when you think that way.
Right, if you're like, what's the common thread and what are we doing next? It's just sort of like...
That's for you guys to worry about.
Yeah. Do I mean more like in just in how you want to do, make a movie?
In terms of the process.
Like the idea of doing a six-day movie or doing
Doing a six-day movie sounds really fun. But...
Yeah, I mean, it definitely affects how we shoot the movies more than what projects we take on. We're just trying to find stories that we are interested in and that seem interesting or new.
I would like to do one where, like, the script is done and we're like, we love this, don't touch a word, let's just worry about how to execute it.
That'll never happen.
I don't know that it'll ever happen. I've never worked that way. But I like the concept. Because then you literally just focus on, then you could storyboard the whole movie before you got to set.
You will never stop having ideas about
it. I know.
It sounded accusatory. You mean?
It did. No, and it is.
You will never stop having ideas. You and your ideas all the time.
No, I'll always, he's right. I'll always be like, you know what? What if?
And do you have any urge to do Fault in Our Stars 2 or?
Yeah, let's do that. But I don't know that we have that gear.
Does it have a ghost in it? Ghost dude?
I think you'd do something dramatic, but it'd be hard to imagine doing something that like was humorless.
Right.
Not saying that that movie is. I haven't seen it.
I
hear it's hilarious.
It has moments.
Yeah.
But there is cancer.
That's a lot of cancer.
Really that funny.
It's not the funniest.
No.
Thing. Yeah, funny moments in 50-50, I thought.
Yeah, that's true.
But you guys don't have an urge to stretch in that
No,
regard.
I think, I we'd like to do things that were more dramatic, but I don't, as Phil's saying, I don't think we would do anything that was completely devoid of humor, you know?
So, like, as far as Jim Brooks, is that where the line is?
Hopefully we're working in this business for a long time, we're going to make lots of different kinds of movies. Yeah. I think just, like, a bleak coal miner drama is probably not in the cards, but... Yeah.
But, you know, the Coens make movies that are, you know, occasionally, like, really dramatic, but they're always kind of weird, and they're always kind of funny. Like, even when Javier Bardem is running around, you know, being the personification of all evil and murdering people, he's wearing a silly wig.
No, that was his cut. They cut his hair.
Yeah, and he's like, they cut
Javier
his hair.
And, it well.
But it's got a, you know, it's got a, it's like a, it's like a weird comedy.
Yeah.
To it, you know what I mean?
But they don't care about the box. They're not worried about opening weekend so much.
No, but isn't that their biggest hit? It's like a massive, massive
hit. Yeah, it's one of
hit.
The two or three.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's interesting because they're a whole thing is they don't really, you know, it's like they do what they do and then.
Yes, and let the chips fall where they may.
But not your, that's not.
No, that's coming from a place of confidence.
Yes, that's not the gear we have.
So can you even imagine what it'll take to make you feel confident? I mean, which sounds silly to me saying it out loud.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I don't think it's in our DNA exactly.
Would you be ruined if you turn confident? Is that the.
That's probably
true. Well, first of all, we wouldn't try quite as hard. There's like a desperation to make sure that it's as good as it can possibly be. Which I think helps the movies be sort of dense with all this different stuff. Even like in the sound mix, we're like adding extra jokes and ideas at the last minute just so that you know, there's something there. We no stone is left unturned.
And there's good anxiety and bad anxiety.
Right. If we're just like, ah,
the stuff we're
great.
Doing now is like kind of bad anxiety. But the fact that like, but sometimes you're anxious because there's a tiger in the room and you need to get away. And sometimes when you're in the middle of editing something, you have to be able to recognize there's a tiger in the room. The movie's not working.
Anxiety
that scene doesn't work.
Like, it's here. That's
important.
We all have anxiety because our ancestors who didn't have anxiety were eaten by the tiger.
Right. That is exactly true. And also our ancestors who didn't worry about what everybody thought of them got kicked out of the tribe and starved to death.
Right.
So I'm worried
like,
about
what
that
you guys
for
all
good
worried,
reason.
Why are you guys all worried about some flood or something? Or
we're worried.
Fires. Yeah. This is going to be fine, you
we're
guys.
We're the survivors.
Now I want to see
we're the future of the human race. Everyone's going to be as like worry-ridden as we are.
Now I want to see your version of Noah.
Yeah. Me too. I'd like to. It would be a much shorter.
It'd be hilarious and short. It'd be a lot about the animals.
And none about the...
Yeah, people.
Yeah.
Be hilarious, sort of Dr. Doolittle type.
Yeah,
that
sounds good.
Dr. Doolittle 3.
Exactly.
This could be another project for you guys.
We're just going to keep rebooting and sequelizing things just to see how terrible an idea we can start with.
and then survive it.
Challenge accepted. Yeah. It's going to be great.
It's going to be great.
It's going to be great. You're going to love it. Everyone's going to love the Chips Ahoy movie that we're working on.
It's like it starts at the factory, and there's like one.
Oh, you guys are going to be great.
He's like doesn't have as many chips as the other person. He lost his chips.
It's a sad story.
He like lost a big poker match. He's lost all his chips, and now he's got to find them.
Double chips meaning.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's not a comedy.
I'm so tired. I can't even think of a Chips Ahoy movie premise.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Do you want to try to do...